Hi everybody, Dr. Abbott here, and I'm going to speak now on test 1, questions 9 to 12. So let me start with this. When did the recording of speech and musical performance begin? Well, a lot of people would point to 1877, Thomas Edison, when he came out with the phonograph, but that's not the question I'm asking. I'm actually asking, when did the recording of speech and musical performance begin? And it started in 1857. So a French scientist named, I'm going to read it, Edouard Léon Scott de Martinville, invented the phonautograph, the first device that could record sound waves as they passed through the air. So this is the first attempt to literally take sound and put it on some sort of medium that you could look at sound.
C'est moi, je suis ici. C'est moi, Garibaldi. C'est moi qui ai juré de délivrer la France et protéger sa liberté. Sa liberté.
What Thomas Edison did was turn it into a business, and he created a machine that could record sound and play back sound. This is what his vehicle was. It was a cylinder. The cylinder has the name of the song on the front, and you'll see there's different colors based on the generations. When we talk about then recorded sound, we're talking about this long arc of technology, basically broken into four different eras. One is an acoustic era, second is an electrical era, a magnetic era, and a digital era. So if we look at, for instance, the electrical era, you could also say transmitting radio waves was the same concept. If we look into the magnetic era, we go into using magnetic tape that looks like this, or the cassette. This is We Are the World, right? The cassette is also magnetic tape. And then, of course, to move into the digital era, this is an early, it's called a mini disc player. It has small, what looks like a tape almost, but it's actually digital recording and playback. That was very important to be able to record and playback. The cell phone and the smart speaker are now how you listen to music primarily. So these different eras have created a passive listening experience. That means you sit there while the music is played for you, and it replaces going to hear music performed live on acoustic instruments or otherwise. So that's number 10. What is the most unique aspect of a live performance? You're there. The most important aspect of a live performance is that you are there. It's a one-time event. Things may happen at that event that may never happen again. Even if it's the same group who's performing in Philadelphia tonight and Baltimore the next night, different things are going to happen because it's live. When you walk into a room and there's a band playing, it changes the atmosphere of the room. So this can change the experience of a dining room where you're going to the restaurant, or a concert hall, or just taking a walk, say, in Meisner Park, and you hear a band playing live in the band shell. Number 11, what activity enhances and develops our ability to appreciate music? One of the things that we talk about in Broward College is critical thinking. Critical thinking is asking, why are you teaching me this? So we're going to apply the same concept. Critical listening. Why am I listening to this? What is of value? What am I actually listening for? And these are the comments, the instructions of Aaron Copland in his very important book, What to Listen For in Music, where he's saying, don't just listen to music, listen for something in the music. So critical listening is what you would primarily do in a music class like this. And of course, that is what we do a lot of. Number 12, music making transcends boundaries. Give some examples. I'm going to give you a couple small examples. One, We Are the World. So you take a group of musicians assembled by Michael Jackson, Lionel Richie, and there's a picture of all of them, and you can see all the people who were invited, and you can see the people who turned down the invitation. And they got together for a big cause, which is for hunger, to end hunger. And this was a big moment. The entire industry gelled, and the whole world sort of gelled around this big moment. This was a musical moment. Now, let's take a non-musical moment, like the Civil Rights Movement. So if you had a typical rally, students, African-American leaders like Martin Luther King, there would always be music accompanying these, and a lot of times it was gospel or spiritual music, songs like We Shall Overcome. So there's a rallying of people that happens when music is part of it. Labor union rallies, Black Lives Matter, there's always a music that's connected somehow to rally people together. So you watch these movements, and you've seen some of these happen in your lifetime. Again, to go back to critical listening, I want you to ask yourself, why is this happening? Why is this happening around music? How is music having an impact on this? Okay, just wanted to have these four questions separate from everything else. And thank you very much, and see you soon.
We're giving nothing back, giving nothing back. Heard those lines a thousand times about how things are getting slack. We're hanging tough this time, and we're standing out on the line. Something close to the end of time, but we're giving nothing back. No, no, we're giving nothing back. The boss, he says to me,